Hello, zoology people. Today I want to talk to you about the phylum Nematoda, the nematodes, the roundworms. The nematodes are from a clade called Ectisozoa. Ectisozoans have a thick cuticle that needs to be molted in order to grow. Probably the most famous ectisozoan are the arthropods. Most of us know that insects and crustaceans and other arthropods have to shed their exoskeleton in order to grow. But it's probably less common knowledge that nematodes also have to shed their thick cuticle in order to grow. The ectisozoans emerged somewhere around the Cambrian period, and the nematodes are probably somewhere along the line evolutionarily related to the arthropods, since both of them have this thick cuticle that needs to be molted in order to grow. So let's talk about some characteristics of the nematodes. There is over 80,000 species described, but there are most likely many more species out there that haven't been discovered yet. The nematodes have a complete digestive system. This means they have a mouth and an anus, but they have no type of osmoregulation. They don't have protonephridia like the flatworms. They don't have a way of filtering out their toxins. So instead, they just secrete toxins straight through their skin. So no type of osmoregulation in the nematodes. The nematodes are bilateral. They have a bilateral symmetry. They are a pseudocoelomate, so they have a space between their organs and their gut, but they're not attached, making it a pseudocoelomate. These guys are not segmented, meaning that their whole body is just one piece. It is a smooth, round worm, no segments on the nematodes. Oh, hello. It must be time for another Mr. Bird Fun Fact. One of the weirdest characteristics about nematodes is they have no cilia or flagella in any way on any of their cells. This means even their sperm has no flagella. Their sperm is amoeboid. It's like a blob that kind of moves towards the eggs to fertilize them. Amoeboid sperm. That's so weird. Mr. Bird Fun Fact. I want to talk about the two classes of nematodes. There's phasmidia and aphasmidia. Phasmidia have phasmids, aphasmidia have no phasmids. Phasmids are sensory organs, and these sensory organs are usually what helps nematode parasites find their host. So phasmidia, the phasmids, these guys are usually parasitic. Aphasmidia, these guys are not parasitic. They are free-living nematodes. So let's talk about a couple examples. There are thousands of examples of nematodes, but I want to talk about just a couple to kind of give you an idea of nematodes. I think one of the funnest ones to teach, because of just how disgusting it is the pinworm. And I like talking about the pinworm because it's the most common parasitic nematode in the United States. So let's talk about the life cycle of the pinworm. So the pinworm, the adult pinworm, lives in the large intestines of children. So in the large intestines of children that have the pinworm, you have these nematodes reproducing inside the large intestines. Well, when there is a pregnant female, a gravid female, what happens is she will migrate in the middle of the night to the anus of the child. And so you have these pinworms living in the intestines of the child. They reproduce, and then the pregnant female will then move at night towards the anus of the child. It will crawl out of the anus of the child, and then it will die on the anus. And what happens is when it dies, it secretes this acid that causes the anus to be itchy. Well, the female, right before she dies, lays her eggs all over the anus and then dies, releasing this itchy acid on the anus. And what happens is the child then scratches their anus because it's itchy, and now the eggs are all over the child's hand and fingernails. So then the child will go touch things, leaving the eggs, and if someone else touches that and then they somehow eat their food or they touch their mouth, they get the eggs inside their body, the eggs will hatch, they will move into the smaller intestines where they will live until they're adults and then move into the larger intestines. And so this process continues. It continues because children scratching their anus and spreading the eggs. And usually I tell my students this, they're horrified and disgusted, and any child that's scratching, they freak out about. Pinworms usually do not affect adults. Our immune system is usually strong enough to get rid of them and kill them, but they can infect adults, and that's why it's usually considered a disease that children get. So those are the pinworms. Totally disgusting. As a zoology teacher, my students see me interacting with many animals. I am interacting with spiders and scorpions and rats and snakes and bats and a lot of things that most people have a fear of. And my students seem to think that I have no fear of any animals. And so they'll ask me a lot of times, Mr. Bird, is there any animal you are afraid of? Yeah, I am terrified of nematode parasites. One in particular is the filarial worm. I am very afraid of filarial worms. Let's talk about this horrifying parasite, the filarial worm. So the way that you contract filarial worms is through a mosquito bite. That's one of the reasons I am so scared of it, because I get bit by mosquitoes all the time. I'm quite tasty when it comes to mosquitoes. And it's pretty hard to prevent yourself from ever getting bit by a mosquito. And so when it's that easy to contract, I get a little scared because I could be in a place where I will get bit by a mosquito that is carrying the filarial worms. So here's what happens. You get bit by a mosquito that has the filarial worm larvae inside the mosquito. They live in the proboscis, the syringe type needle, the mouth part of the mosquito. So you have these larvae filarial worms in that proboscis. The mosquito lands on you. It will then start sucking your blood, and then the larvae of the filarial worm will then travel into your skin through the mosquito, through that proboscis. Now the larvae will go inside your skin. They will start to live there and they will start to grow. They start to turn into adult-sized filarial worms. They're a very thin worm, thin nematode worm. And what they do is they like to live in your lymphatic system. Your lymphatic system is the system that exchanges fluids between your body parts through your skin. And so this fluid is passed back and forth through your different muscle tissues. And so these filarial worms like to eat that lymphatic fluid. And what usually happens is they will find an area to conjugate. And so you'll have a whole bunch of filarial worms living in the lymphatic system somewhere in your body. And what this leads to is a disease called elephantiasis. You've probably heard of elephantiasis. Some people mistakenly call it elephantitis. It's called elephantiasis. So elephantiasis happens when you have so many filarial worms blocking the lymphatic system in one particular part of your body. And what happens is that lymph fluid can no longer reach the skin or that muscle tissue or that area of your body. And then it can't be removed either, because the lymphatic system is a two-way system where the fluid needs to go back and forth. So you have an area that is now blocked by all of these worms. And this is when you get this huge swelling of a certain area because it's filling with lymphatic fluid. And then usually the tissue or the skin in that area becomes very dry and starts to die because that lymphatic fluid is not getting to the skin area. It's not getting to that section, but it's also being trapped in the muscle tissue and in that area where the worms are living. And this is where it gets its name elephantiasis, because people have described people with it as having elephant-like skin and a giant proportioned part of their body because of that lymphatic fluid filling up in a certain area. If you want to see some horrifying pictures, just look up elephantiasis. So you now have these filarial worms living inside you and they're reproducing. Well, now if a mosquito comes and bites you, the mosquito will carry off the larvae. So what happens is those filarial worms are living inside you and they're reproducing. Well, there's larvae filarial worms inside you. At night, the larvae will travel to the skin close to the surface, and they're just waiting for a mosquito. So if a mosquito happens to bite you, they will pull up some of the larvae and then travel and carry that to another person. And this is how the filarial worms are contracted and spread. So if a person that has filarial worms gets bit by a mosquito, and then that same mosquito bites someone else, they can now spread the filarial worms. One of the things that makes it so horrifying and scary is that once you have filarial worms, you have them for life. We can't remove them. They reproduce way too quickly, and you have too many of them inside your tissue and throughout your body. And so once you contract filarial worms, what happens is you get diagnosed, and then you take medication. That medication kills the filarial worms, but it doesn't kill all of them. What it does is it keeps the numbers down. So you keep taking this medication to keep killing the bulk of the filarial worms, and hopefully this will stave off elephantiasis. So if you continue to keep their numbers down, you'll live a normal life because the worms are not conjugating in large numbers causing that elephantiasis. But we can't get rid of the worm permanently. Hopefully in the future, we will find a way to permanently get rid of the worm. But people that have filarial worms, they carry them with them for life. And it's not contagious in any other means besides a mosquito bite. So you can be around someone with elephantiasis or with filarial worms and you're not gonna contract it unless a mosquito bites them and bites you. And so this is why countries that have filarial worms, like countries like India and some of the tropics, places like that, are always trying to protect themselves from mosquitoes, because you can get filarial worms and many other parasites through mosquitoes. So they have mosquito nets over their beds, over their windows, because these are dangerous and sometimes deadly diseases. So when students ask me, what am I afraid of? I'm afraid of parasitic nematodes. Filarial worms are not the only horrific one out there. There are many, many scary nematode parasites, but I think filarial worms are one of the scariest. Another common nematode parasite is Anisakis. Let's talk about Anisakis for a moment, because there are an increasing number of people who get infected with Anisakis nematodes. So the Anisakis nematode starts its life as an egg, like most worms. This egg hatches, and then the larvae will infect a crustacean, like a shrimp. It goes into this shrimp, and it'll live off the shrimp and grow for a little bit. And then what happens is it'll then infect a fish. So it'll leave the shrimp and enter a fish. Once it goes into the fish, it's going to become a sporocyst. We've heard that word before. Sporocyst, the dormant stage. It'll go into the muscle of a fish, and it'll live there waiting for a large mammal. The large mammal is the main host of Anisakis. So the fish and the crustacean, those are intermediate hosts. Those are hosts on its life cycle waiting until it gets to its main host where it will reproduce. So the Anisakis worms want to get to a marine mammal, like a dolphin or a seal or a sea lion. And so what happens is if a dolphin or a sea lion eats that fish that has Anisakis worms living in its muscle, those Anisakis worms will now become adults. They will infect the intestines and stomach of the dolphin and the sea lion, and then they will reproduce, and then those mammals will secrete the eggs in their feces. Well, the problem is humans are now getting Anisakis because of the increased popularity of sushi. And so if they were to take a fish that had Anisakis worms living in the meat of that fish, they chop it up fresh and serve it as sushi, you eat these worms, now the Anisakis worm thinks you are a marine mammal. We have a very similar system to the marine mammals because we're all mammals. And so this Anisakis worm gets inside you, and now you have an Anisakis nematode worm infection. And when I teach my students about this, they usually get horrified and say, I'm never eating sushi again. Well, let's talk about some of the ways you can protect yourself from getting parasitic nematodes. It always comes from eating raw meat. Eating raw meat is always a bad idea. We can get nematodes from pork. There's a pork worm. We can get nematodes from beef. There is a beef worm. Besides also the flatworms like tapeworms that live in pork and beef, but there's also nematodes that live in pork and beef. And they're very similar to the life cycle of a tapeworm, which is a flatworm. But we're talking about roundworms. We're talking about nematoda. Okay, so if you cook your meat, you kill the sporocysts, or you kill the worm that is living in that meat. So if you get a hamburger, you make sure you cook it, and that will kill those worms. Fire kills everything. And so by cooking your meat, you're getting rid of any chance you're gonna have of catching those parasitic worms. Well, but sushi, the whole point of sushi is it's uncooked fish. So what do we do? Well, what you're supposed to do is freeze it. Freezing the meat also kills the worms. And so when you catch fresh fish that's going to be sushi, they're supposed to, and when I say they, restaurants or whoever's gonna serve sushi, are supposed to take that fish and freeze it. That way it kills any parasitic worms living inside that fish, then they thaw it, and then they serve it as sushi. And so you wanna make sure that you're getting sushi that was frozen first. Because if it wasn't, if it was fresh, there are chefs that say the best sushi is fresh sushi. Well, now you're now susceptible to catching nematode parasitic worms. You're susceptible to catching Anisakis. So if they take a fresh fish, chop it up, and serve it right then and there, those worms that were living in that fish are still gonna be alive if that fish had Anisakis worms. And so freezing it is a way to protect yourself from catching parasites. And the other option, the best option, is cooking your meat. Well, I could go on and on talking about all of the different parasitic nematodes that are out there. Like I said, there are thousands of them, and many of them more horrifying than the next. And so if you're really interested in that, start looking up some parasitic nematodes. Read some of the stories. Read some of the interesting ways that you can contract these nematodes. But don't do it to where you make yourself paranoid. I hope you enjoyed learning about the Phylum Nematoda, the roundworms, and I'll see you guys next time.